Today is April 3rd, 2013, 69 years after Major Edmund H. Wolcott was shot down on his 25th mission by enemy flak. Ed, thank you for talking to me today. My name is Bob Polito. We are at Ed's home at 6 Duck River Lane in Old Lyme, and I'd like to talk with Ed about his U.S. Army Air Corps experiences. Ed, can you start with your father, who was in World War I, and his experience and how he helped shape you getting into the service?
You bet. As a young man growing up in Bay Ridge, Brooklyn, back in the, about 1910 or so, a bunch of he and his friends joined the National Guard out at, I think it was Fort Totten in Brooklyn, because it was a cavalry outfit, and they got to play with the horses. And so there was a lark for them all. They had a good time and so forth. There were a bunch of them from the neighborhood my dad grew up in. And surprisingly enough, one day they got the call. The war was raging, World War I was raging in Europe, and America was still not involved in it. And Black Jack Pershing, turned out to be the commanding officer, was given command of this, whatever they were called, a squadron or, no, I guess more of a regiment or something of cavalry. And my dad and all his buddies wind up on a train with their horses, and next thing they know, they're dumped out down in Texas. Their mission was to try to catch or neutralize Pancho Villa. The Germans had encouraged and paid the Mexican free-for-allers to cause trouble on our borders to keep our attention from Europe, I guess. And so they were down there for a few months. They never caught anybody except a bunch of rattlesnakes and so forth, and a lot of sunburn. But it was quite an experience for them all. And then suddenly America's involved in World War I, and they're all recalled and back on the train. And as my dad told the story, they were dumped out in South Carolina, and the next thing they knew, they were introduced, the horses were gone, and they were introduced to a machine gun. So they went through that training and over to Newport News or someplace on a ship, and they wind up in Brest in France a couple of weeks later. And on another train, I think they call it 40 and 10 or something. They can get 10 horses on one of these baggage cars, or 40 personnel, as my dad used to tell the story. He never talked much about World War I when I was a kid. I think it was a bad experience, and he had a few remaining friends, but lost most of his boyhood pals. Were buried in France. In any case, he just didn't like to talk about it much, so I'm really fishing for stories and trying to recall what he did say. But to bring it up to my involvement, right. And incidentally, he did come home, walked up Fifth Avenue with a bunch of strangers, and then he was an artist by nature, but when he came home from Europe, the money was in Wall Street, so he became a broker in Wall Street for many years, but art was always his hobby. And curiously enough, when I got involved in the service, I had graduated from high school in spring of 41 and was up at Colgate as a freshman. And all of a sudden, it it becomes December 7th, 1941, Pearl Harbor. And we all turned out on a campus wondering what the hell was going on. And the picture was eventually made clear that America had been attacked in Europe, in Asia, in the Pacific. And a few days later, Roosevelt addressed the nation and declared a war on the Japanese. Well, Pearl Harbor was similar to 9/11 in many ways. Almost 3,000 people were killed, most of them service people, some local civilians, but the majority of the deaths were Navy personnel, because the American fleet in the Pacific, the major part of it was at Pearl Harbor. Fortunately, the carriers were all out at sea someplace, so the Japs had screwed up a little, and they did sink an awful lot of heavy equipment. Yeah. And like I say, at least a couple of thousand Navy, a few Air Corps guys, some Marine guys, a few Army people. But it was an eye-opener, and as we got talking about it at Colgate, why and on all campuses, I'm sure, why it became clear that we were going to be involved in this thing as young men. You know, we were all in our teens or thereabout, and I called home and spoke to my dad. And he said the best advice he could give me was just to stay in school and get your education as long as you can, and they'll catch up to you sooner or later. Well, at 19, and with always had been interested in airplanes and made airplane models, all that kind of thing as a kid, why, I was kind of anxious to, like most of the class. I think half of the school volunteered within a week or two, and I didn't wait for the Navy to arrive, because the Army Air Corps recruiters were on campus within a week or two, and so setting my dad's good advice aside, I joined the Army Air Corps, and shortly after I wound up down in Alabama, and this old jacket I've got on here was the first thing that was issued to me, and that was in 1942, and it doesn't fit me anymore. It won't do this like it did in those days, but and as a matter of fact, want to divert just a bit. The reason I even have it is because I got smashed up on my 25th mission and wound up in the hospital system. And I came home, unlike most guys that came home, they turned all this stuff in when you checked out, you know, when you left the service. Why, you didn't take this with you. But I was in the hospital system, and I even came home in my own 45. And but I'd lost my parachute. And you won't believe it, but 4 or 5 years later, some guy walked in my office. I had a temporary command of base operations, and some woebegotten place, I think it was called Alliance, Nebraska, but they were servicing equipment, airplanes coming back from Europe, and we were servicing them, mostly DC-3s, and they were headed for the Pacific, because the Pacific War was still going on. And a guy walked in my office one day and introduced himself, sat down, opened his briefcase, and handed me a pile of papers and asked where my parachute was. Well, of course, I was in a hospital system, still was, actually. I was released on temporary duty from the hospital because they had to wait for this injury I had. It was a nerve injury, and a nerve only grows a centimeter a month, so it took 3.5 years before they could release me from the hospital. In any case, I had this temporary duty to try to build what we called MOSs, Military Occupational Specialties. And I liked flying. I liked the Air Force, the Air Corps, actually. And I wanted to stay in. I figured they're going to have a lot of applicants. A lot of guys are going to want to stay in. And at any rate, that's why I was running base operations way out in the boonies. And he wanted to know what happened to my parachute. Well, we'll get to it, I guess, as Bob asked me other questions about it. Yeah. But the parachute got lost in that 25th mission. And it was hard to explain to this gravel gripper that when an airplane gets shot up by an awful lot of things get lost.
Wow.
But at any rate, he didn't charge me for it. I guess he walked off and tore up the paper or something. I don't know. Where are we, Bob? Diverted a bit.
So when you entered the service, where did you do your pilot training?
Okay. I was shipped down to Alabama, and the first thing we got was we were lined up, and we stripped, and they checked us with a thermometer, and I remember getting needles stuck in me, both arms, about a dozen shots, and then the end of the line, they handed you a uniform, including this A2 jacket, and you wound up in a barrack someplace, and then somebody came in and turned you out. And of course, we didn't know how to march or how to salute or how to stand at attention, and we just kind of rattled around for a week or so. And we went through what was called classification. We took exams, written and oral exams, before boards that were set up, and we were, at the end of a week or so, we were classified as pilot, bombardier, and navigator. And this is where the group that I went down with all got split up, and those of us who had been lucky enough to get the pilot training offer, we went off to, the first was a basic training. No airplanes. I forgot where it was. I think it was somewhere in Alabama. But it was basic training, yes or no, sir, and how to eat a square meal, and how to stand attention, and how to march, and a lot of running. A lot of what did they call them, Bob? Calisthenics, but, obstacle courses.
Oh, man. Yeah.
And none of us were in good condition. I mean, you know, we were young, but by the time we finished 3 months of basic training, why, at least we were in a lot better physical condition than we'd ever been. Yeah. And we did learn how to salute properly and so forth, you know, rather than doing this.
Yeah, right. Australia.
Any of you who have been through basic, yes, understand, and we got done in 3 months, whereas some of the guys that, like the Marines and so forth, I guess, infantry outfits, you know, get it real seriously. But they just wanted to give us a taste of it so we could look like soldiers. And then if we got through that, not everybody did. Some guys just couldn't hack it, and they disappeared. And so the first sight of an airplane was 3 months later with primary flight training, which was in Arkansas someplace. And brand new airfield, brand new barracks, and biplanes, Stearman biplanes. Oh, a whole line of them out there on the flight line, beautiful things. And about six of us were broken out of from the whole bunch, and we were introduced to our instructor. I can still remember mine. He was really a hayseed from the hills of Kentucky or somewhere. His name was Harkarov. Can you imagine remembering that after all these years? A great guy, a hell of a pilot, and he took us under his wing, and the the morning session, why we'd go to the flight line and they would sit in the ready room and he'd explain what he wanted. Well, of course, the first thing was just takeoffs, and you sat in the front seat of this two-seater, and the instructor sat in the back, and there was no communication. He had gone through what he wanted you to do, and he had instructed us before we arrived at the flight line that just to follow him through on the controls. Hold the stick and put your hand on the throttle and your feet on the rudder pedals and brake pedals, and follow him through what he did. Well, he took the airplane off and climbed, made turns, and just stayed in the pattern, came back around, made the approach and the landing, taxied back around. Did that a few times, and then the next guy of the six went through it. So that was the first taste of flying an airplane. It was quite an experience. It seemed so foreign, you know, to leave the ground and wonder what was going on here and following through with this stuff and everything. And after about 3 or 4 hours, if you had done things properly, the air work, incidentally, after a few takeoff and landings, following the instructor through, he let you do it. But if you screwed up a little bit, you could feel his hand on it, and he'd make any corrections that were necessary, but you'd get off and leave the traffic pattern and go into one of the four zones around the airport and climb to 3,000 or 4,000 feet. And then there was a curriculum that you followed in primary and all through the training. Turns, right and left turns to maintain altitude, a shallow bank, a steep bank, and so forth, 360-degree turns, and to roll out on the proper heading again for accuracy and get the feel of the airplane and so forth. Then they started a series of stalls because, you know, if you stalled an airplane, you had to know how to recover from it. So there were power-on stalls and power-off stalls. It pulled straight ahead. When the airplane started to shake, it would drop out of the sky and start to spin. And the proper procedure for correcting from a spin was opposite rudder and stick and so forth and no power, and then add power as you... And you had to break your spin. You'd line up on a road, and he'd ask you to stall the airplane in line with the road on the ground. And then, usually about three turns, you were to correct from the spin and finish and line up on the road and climb back up to altitude. Proficiency and accuracy and so forth were all involved in how you dealt with the turns and spins and from stalls, and that was basically what we went through for the flight training part of primary training. And then half the day was on the flight line. The other half of the day was split between classroom work and the torture out on running around the perimeter of the field for a few hours, you know, and or the obstacle course, more of that. If you got through primary flight training, and not everybody did, we went to basic training. The same sort of thing, only a bigger airplane, and with radio and so forth, and you still sat in the front seat, the instructor in the back seat, and but you did cross-country navigational work, and you still did stalls and turns and landings and takeoffs and so forth. Oh, incidentally, it was quite an experience when the instructor thought you were ready after landing, you'd taxi back around, and he'd get out of the back seat, and he'd stand beside you on the airplane. He said, "I think you're ready. You're ready to go solo this thing." And most of us were anxious to.
Yeah.
And so it was quite an experience to line up with nobody back there and push the throttle and get that thing off the airplane and make the turns around the pattern. And you're looking for other aircraft and so forth all the time, you know. It's a lot to pay attention to. And line up, make the approach to the runway and touch down and land. So it was quite a thrill to solo it.
What plane was that, Ed?
That was in the Stearman.
Okay.
It was a great training. It was a heavy airplane, but it took a lot of punishment.
Yeah.
And they still are around.
Wow.
You see them occasionally. As a matter of fact, Lynn, a couple of years ago, bought me an hour's flight in one. There's one up at Chester Airport.
Wow.
Belongs to some guy. And he has an old airline pilot. Must be 60 or 70. That is retired, but flies people around and often flies over here. A steerman makes a noise. Well, all airplanes have their own signature. And Lynn and I will be, my wife and I will be sitting out on a terrace during the summer, and we'll hear this sound, and right away you know it's a steerman.
Yeah, yeah.
And with any luck, you fly over the house on his way around the area, you know.
Yeah.
It's quite a thrill to see him. Hear the noise and so forth. In any case, then basic training is a little more complicated, and 3 months of that, and the flying and the ground school and so forth. If you get through that, you have 3 more months of you've accumulated about 25, 30 hours in primary, about the same in basic. Excuse me. You go to advanced training. And I didn't want fighters. I wanted twin engine attack bombers, but I wound up in B-17s and B-24s. But the call at the time was to build up the American Air Forces in England with the 8th Air Force and the 15th Air Force down in North Africa and Italy. So we were attacking Germany from both sides and getting to all their factories and railroads, and the big target for us, because we were closer to the British, the 8th Air Force couldn't reach the oil fields in eastern Germany and in Romania, but the 15th out of Italy, we had it was about a 3-hour ride up to the oil fields, and we spent a lot of time bombing oil fields, because without oil, why? Excuse me, nothing runs. Airplanes, tanks, submarines, you need a lot of oil.
Yeah.
One of the reasons Germany lost the war was because they ran out of fuel. So it was very important. In any case, we completed advanced flight training, which was in a beautiful little twin-engine airplane called an 18-9. It was lovely. Great little thing, side by side with the instructor, and or with often once we had soloed in it after a couple of hours, why we buddy rode each other, and we flew a lot of cross country, a lot of navigational work, of course landings and takeoffs and the stall procedures, all that sort of thing, repeated in every airplane you get in, and a lot of hard work, and you know, anybody can learn to fly an airplane, like learn to fly drive a car or anything else. Some learn faster than others, and some have a little more natural aptitude than others, but anybody can learn. The thing during the war was you have to learn very quickly, and if you didn't pick up on takeoff and landings and air work and all the rest, or even the physical stuff, the obstacle courses, or whether you couldn't keep up, you were gone.
Yeah.
And so the classes that I was able to keep up with and so forth, by the time we finished, I don't think more than about half of us completed the aviation cadet courses, the way it was presented, the way it was written, the way it was worked. There was a curriculum involved that the instructors found that prepared us for what came next. But earning your wings was really a big deal. And we were awfully, awfully happy to have completed the courses, those of us who completed it, and earned our silver wings. It was a real thrill.
Yeah, yeah.
It was a lot of work and so on, but a great deal of satisfaction.
Absolutely.
And in your case, shall I go on,
yes,
Bob?
Yes, please.
Okay, after that, why operational training loomed before us. I had selected heavies rather than fighters and wound up in a B-17 transition school in Texas. And again, about a 3-month course, same thing, but now in the right seat with the instructor in the left seat, and takeoffs, landings, air work, and then high altitude work, because as bombers, why, we had to get as far away as we could from ground guns, from anti-aircraft guns. Excuse me, the Germans had very accurate 88 and 105 millimeter guns that just chewed the hell out of us, even up at 25,000 feet.
Wow.
And of course, the fighters, the Messerschmitts and the Focke-Wulfs and so forth, were very aggressive, and they had been through the war in Spain, and so we were up against guys who were real aces,
yeah,
you know.
Yeah,
that,
yeah.
When our guys who were trying to protect us, but they were flying P-40s and P-38s, and they were no match for the Germans in equipment,
right,
or in tactics and in skill.
Yeah.
So it wasn't until, let's see, I completed flight training the 17 in the spring of 43, and then instructed for a while. So in the fall, early fall of 43, I transitioned into B-24, similar airplane, it's four engines, and very heavy. The 17 was the original four-engine bomber, but it was difficult to build. They built by hand, and the air forces, the air corps, needed so many to do the job that they couldn't wait on 17 construction. And so they designed this B-24, which was a similar airplane, except it was all built around the Bombay. And we carried the Flying Fortress carried 8 500-pound bombs. We carried 12 in a 24. So it was a big difference. And it was well built. But it was built like a Model A Ford. The parts came together in a factory, and they ran one out every hour. And as a consequence, about 20,000 B-17s were constructed in a couple of years, whereas the 17s, I don't think they ever completed more than about 10,000, maybe. In any case, it was a good airplane, the 24. It did the job. The trouble was, from a pilot standpoint, it had what they call a high aspect ratio wing, a Davis wing. It was long and narrow. It was very efficient, but at high altitude where the air is thin, it was a handful, particularly with a load of 6,000 pounds of bombs and probably 4,000 or 5,000 pounds of high octane fuel. Why, and 10 crew members. Why, they were heavy as the blazes, and they were a handful. And you know, by the time we got to fly in four-engine bombers, why, we had had quite a bit of flying time, we pilots, but there were two of us, a co-pilot and the pilot command, or the left seat. Then we had a nose gunner in a turret with twin 50 guns, and sitting right underneath him over the bomb site was a bombardier, and right under my feet, underneath me, was a navigator with a window beside him. And then over my head, a co-pilot beside me, and then over my head was another gunner. These are all enlisted men. But it had twin 50 calibers. When that went off, it was right over your head. The noise was terrible. Oh, and a lot of the attacks from the fighters was frontal and come right in at you. So this thing going off right over your head and the nose guns going. And then working your way back through the bomb bay, there was a ball turret, which was a nightmare. It was small, and a guy sat with his legs up underneath him, and with twin 50 guns in his lap, and he got in this thing through a hatch behind the bomb bay in the waist of the airplane, and then the hatch closed, and he was locked into this thing. Then he descended it, so it was hanging below the belly of the airplane, and all he could see was the wingtips. But he had the full swing all the way around and all the way down and so forth. So it was a miserable position. And guys put up with it. This is what they trained for. And then behind him, there were big open windows in both the 17 and the 24 on the right and left side. And a gunner on each side with a single 50 caliber, and standing at those open windows with most of the clothes you owned on, because at 25,000 feet the temperature was 50 to 60 below zero, and they're standing at an open window. And there was a lot of frostbite, and of course any place in the airplane was the same temperature outside as it was inside, and at 50 below zero, and then above 10,000 feet, you're all on oxygen masks. That was a pleasure. Oh, God, it was uncomfortable. And then behind the waist guns, there was a tail gunner in a turret, and he had twin 50s. And so we were heavily armed, but there was no armor. I mean, the side of the airplane was about the thickness of a piece of cardboard, and was about as there was no protection from it, from the flak of fighters. I can't tell you the number of 17s and 24s out of England and Italy that were shot down. And it was awfully difficult to get out of them if the airplane were hit and was going down. The waist gunners could get out easy, not before they tried to get the ball turret up and the guy out of it. But if an airplane was in a bank or a turn or a spin, everybody was flying all over the place. It was awfully difficult. And, you had a headset on with a wire connected to it. You had an oxygen mask with a tube connected to something. I mean, it was rough. We weren't pressurized. We weren't heated. And we weren't armored. It was tough duty.
Yeah.
And if at 25,000 feet you got hit and lost control of the airplane, something blew up or so forth, it took 8 to 10 minutes to get to the ground if you were still alive and couldn't get out. It was a tough way to go to buy the farm. And we lost a lot of people. I think the total was something like, I've kind of forgotten, but it was in the hundreds of thousands of airmen that were lost over Europe and, of course, in the Pacific, in fighters and twin-engine attack bombers, the B-26, the B-20, the A-20, and the B-25. The losses were fierce. And they always kidded the Air Force. because in my own squadron, I had had this extra flying time, so when I checked into this new squadron, there were four squadrons in the 450th Bomb Group, which I was attached to in Alamogordo, New Mexico, and we completed three months of training in that, flying a lot of formation. We had to learn to keep the airplanes tight when we were being attacked or when we were on our bomb run, because if we were spread all over the sky, the bombs didn't get where they had to get to do the job. And we were after railroad yards, which were concentrated. We were after the oil fields, which were an easy target because they were spread all over the place. But concentration of troops, which we sometimes went after in Albania and in southern France and Germany, and even in northern Italy as the Germans were retreating, why, our targets were tough. And the intercept from the fighters, and let me backtrack a bit. When we completed our flight training, operational training in Arizona, the 450th Bomb Group got its okay, and we got brand new factory fresh airplanes. They were delivered by little girls, waifs, I guess they were. But they brought these big heavy bombers in, and half of them could barely reach the foot pedals, you know. In fact, it seems to me they had to put a block around some of the foot pedals for them to even be able to reach the controls and the brakes. At any rate, they brought these airplanes in, they got out, left, and disappeared. And we signed, each of us who were aircraft commanders, signed for our own airplane, and I can remember to this day, $485,000. I signed on a line for one each B-Summit, B-17, B-24. And it was my airplane. And then my crew collected, and we trained as a crew and so forth, a bunch of good guys.
And this is fall of 1943.
To be beginning, let me see. Yeah, that's right.
So it's almost 2 years since Pearl Harbor.
That's right.
And you're still stateside.
Still training.
All training.
Yeah.
Wow.
Unbelievable.
Yeah.
I mean, the design, build, test, and produce these airplanes, for instance, and everything that went into them, and the personnel to fly them and fight them, and the gunners, you know, it came from all over the place. And the bombardiers had to train on the Norden bomb site.
Right.
And of course, the navigators had to train someplace and so forth. We all collected at this particular place, and guys I'd never seen before, but I wound up with 10 great guys, a co-pilot had minimum time. He had nearly the amount of time that I had collected because of the B-17 thing, but he was a good pilot, just no experience, but you picked that up on the job.
Right.
The gunners, you hoped they were good. The navigator was, again, you hope like hell. The bombardier, you didn't know from beans, you know, and so forth, but there were four officers and six enlisted men on a crew of a B-17 or a B-24.
Right.
So we all get together and train together for 3 months, and then off we go. And we're cleared to fly the airplane in my case. Of course, we went in all different directions, but in my case, the 450th Bomb Group was cleared from Alamogordo to West Palm Beach, Florida. So we took off whenever we were ready and found our way, our navigators. In those days, there were very few navigational aids. It was all dead reckoning and pilotage. You had basic instrument panel, and you could fly in a lot of weather, but not the way you learned to fly. I flew with the airlines for 31 years after I finally got out of the hospital. with Eastern, as a matter of fact, and the progress that had been made from the days I flew with a simple instrument panel and just a radio and a beacon, no electronics to speak of, and sat-nav, which was in its infancy, it didn't amount to much. At any rate, we found our way, my navigator found our way down to Florida, and we landed in Palm Beach, West Palm Beach, and one by one we staggered in. There were four squadrons in the 450th. I was in the 721st, and there was the 722nd and 3rd and the 720th, I guess, four squadrons. And there were 10 airplanes in each squadron. So it was quite a bunch of guys. But as we started our trip overseas, we realized suddenly the easy part is over. We're going where you could get seriously hurt. It finally dawns on you. Don't forget. 20 years old, 21 years old, I guess. 43, I was 21. Command of a big, heavy bomber with 9 other crew members, you know. What a deal. I mean, when you look back on it, even after all these years, you just wonder how the hell the job got done. I mean, in our particular thing, flying these big heavy airplanes, but in the submarine service, on battleships, you know, and the Navy pilots on and off these carriers. I mean, how the hell did it all get done? 17 million guys trained.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, who the hell designed this jacket and built it?
Yeah.
And we had fur-lined flight equipment because of the altitude, and trying to survive, you know, for 4 hours, 5 hours at a time, at 50 below zero, you know, with fur-lined helmets and oxygen mask and so forth, and with fighters, you know, all over, and then flak. Oh God, when you start a bomb run, shall I get into mission?
You're in Florida, and where did you head
first? Okay, yeah. We got down to Palm Beach. We didn't lose anybody. We all arrived there sooner or later, and it didn't matter. We didn't wait for anybody. We got there. There'd be a bunch of us. The next morning, we'd get there late in the afternoon. We'd have dinner, go to bed, wake up early, like 6 o'clock, 5, 6 o'clock, go to briefing. And a big briefing room with maps and so forth. And a weather guy who would explain the weather. Our next stop from Florida was Puerto Rico. On the western tip of Puerto Rico was Barranquin Field. It was an Army Air Force base. And it was, 1,200 miles, I think, something like that. It was a long ride. And no navigational aids. It was all dead reckoning. And you prayed you had a good navigator, because all we did was drive them. We had a lap full of maps, and we look out the window and look at rivers and railroads and, you know, cities and so forth, and hope we knew where the hell we were. But and then a radio beacon once in a while, and that helped us. And we had radio compasses that did this, wiggle around, you know. We'd set them up to help us get across country and so forth. But we really depended on a navigator. So we took off in the dark and climbed out. And there's an interesting story I won't get into because you probably want to hear it, but I had grown up, the reason I wanted to fly Navy was because my next door neighbor was a young man who was about 5 years older than I was. He died last year, but he graduated from Annapolis and served a year or two on a battleship, and then volunteered for flight training, and he graduated Pensacola and flew F-4Fs, F-6F fighters off carriers in the Pacific. His name was Doug Clark. He was a neat guy, and he was what I was a single child, but he was my older brother. And I followed around. If he stopped short, I ran into him. I mean, it was, you know, it was a pain. I was sure I was a pain to him, but he put up with it for years. When I was flying over the northern part of Florida, I was pretty sure Doug was with, he'd come back from a tour of duty in the Pacific on a carrier. He'd pick up a new group and train them. He was, I think he was a lieutenant commander or so. He wasn't a captain yet. And he'd train this crowd, probably a couple of dozen new fighter pilots right out of school. He'd train them, fighter tactics and all the rest, you know, that those guys went through. And I was pretty sure he was in Melbourne or somewhere, so I called the tower. I knew the frequency. I mean, we got, you know, I was able to find the frequency of the tower of Melbourne. I think that's where it was. So I called him when I was getting near, and I said, "This is Lieutenant Wolcott. I'm up here on the B-24 on my way to West Palm Beach. And do you have a commander, Lieutenant Commander Clark, Doug Clark? Do you know?" And he said, "Yeah, yeah, we all know Doug." I said, "Oh God!" I said, "Tell you what, he's out on a training session." I said, "When he comes in, tell him Ed Wolcott's overhead in the B-24, headed for West Palm Beach." I knew if now no sooner landed in West Palm and taxied into a thing when here comes an F-4F and pulled in right beside me.
No kidding.
And it's my brother, my older brother, Doug Clark.
Yeah. Wow.
Well, what a reunion, because I hadn't seen him in a couple of years, you know. When he graduated from Annapolis, he invited myself and my mother to his graduation. And at the end of the graduation, they do this with their hats, but Doug went under his arm with his hat.
Yeah.
And he gave it to me.
Wow.
After graduation and so forth. His parents were there, of course, which was my second family. And I think I wore that hat out. I said,
wow.
In high school, yeah. I wore it. At any rate, Doug was a great guy and a great pilot. He had ribbons. He had I know he had at least one Navy Cross.
Wow.
He didn't have a Purple Heart, fortunately.
Yes.
But he survived the Pacific fight, came back, and stayed in aviation most of his career. He sold airplanes and demonstrated airplanes. He got out of the Navy as a captain. He had a heart problem. That's what it was, and they had to let him go. But he put in, I don't know, almost 20 years probably anyway. But he was a terrific guy. He died last year from a heart problem. He had had a 4 bypass thing during the years. But my wife and I would meet him in Florida every winter, you know, we go down.
It sounds like he lived into well into his 90s.
He did. 95.
95.
Yeah.
Some heart problem.
Because I'm 90, and he was 5 years older than I was. And but the last few years were pretty bad. We'd speak on the phone. Or
yeah.
Christmas cards. Or
yeah.
At any rate, so Doug is gone now.
Sorry.
So where the hell was I? Okay. Puerto Rico.
Yes.
Then the next leg was, I think, down to Trinidad. And for Trinidad, it was somewhere else. We wound up on the east coast of South America at a place called, I think it was Belém. It was a brand new airport and no facilities, really. They had lots of 100-octane fuel. So we pulled in there, navigated, flying down across the coast of South America. All of a sudden, Vic Meeker, my navigator, said, "Here comes the Amazon River." Sure enough, there goes the Amazon off into the distance, you know. We're flying down along the, a lot of it over water, over the Bahamas, and then, of course, the Atlantic Ocean, all the way down to South America. And we're briefed for the flight. We're going to fly across the Atlantic Ocean. You know, 21 years old, I'm going to fly a 450,000-pound airplane across the Atlantic Ocean? Okay. So, but all of us were doing it. You didn't question it. You just did it. Somebody said, "You go there." You go, "Yes, sir," and off you go. So, and the other 9 guys, they just shrug and get aboard. You know, they don't know any better either. They hope to hell you know what you're doing up there in the cockhouse, but
right.
In any case, we get the briefing, which wasn't much. You take off from here and you fly east. Okay, for 11 hours. That's 11 hours. I don't know. I've forgotten the mileage across it. We flew from Belém to Dakar in French West Africa. It's where the easternmost part of South America is to the easternmost part of Africa.
Okay.
It's the shortest distance between the two. And so we take off in the dark and the rain and we climb on out. Of course, we don't go to 25,000 feet. We usually cruise where we didn't need oxygen if weather permitted, because it was such a nuisance to put those masks on. But I should say, for those who don't know, without oxygen, above 10,000 feet, higher you can't go, but above 10,000 feet for military purposes, you only had 3 or 4 minutes and you pass out. So you had to have oxygen.
Yeah.
And if your oxygen equipment was hit by flak or fighters, you had to descend, because you couldn't continue. In any case, there are so many asides that I could get into that occur to me as we're as I'm chatting here about this with you, Bob. Yeah. My mind it's hard to keep it on one.
That's good.
One track.
That's good. Wherever you want to go.
No. I don't want to bore you with a lot of stuff. But
not at all.
Oh, when I took off from West Palm, Doug and I had dinner together, and as overseas personnel, I wasn't supposed to leave the airport. But we had met a couple of girls in the old club. We had dinner with them, and they said, come on, we'll take you into town. Well, Doug could go. He was okay. But I wasn't allowed off the airport, so they put me in a trunk. We went through the gate, you know, the guards just cleared us. We went into town. They got me out of the trunk, and we had a few drinks and some dancing, and we had a great evening. And got me back on base the same way. And Doug sat in on the briefing and went out to our airplanes. And had a hug, and he got in his fighter. He followed me out for takeoff, got off the ground out over the water. And Doug pulled up on my left wing in his little fighter, you know. Yeah. And he pulled out a little way, and then he rolled right around me. Oh, I couldn't see him. I don't know where the hell he's going. And the guys on the interphone, the gunners, is going, he's over me now. He's down over there, you know. The way he's going, said, no, he's over here now.
Yeah.
And Doug came up over and back on my left wing again.
Wow.
Oh, God, he was good.
Heck of a pilot.
Yeah. Anyway, he flew there for a little while, and, you know, we waved at each other.
Yeah.
I think he popped the top of his head like this. I think that was his salute. I forgot, kind of, but I remember him doing this.
Huh.
And then, he's gone, you know. And at any rate, we're off Belém, en route across the Atlantic, and there are no signposts out there, just a lot of water. And we're about 10,000, 12,000 feet, something like that. And Vic Meeker is staring out the window, you know, looking at the waves and trying to get an idea which direction the wind is coming from. Yeah, the clue, of course, you know, it's just guesswork, pilotage. And he had an astrodome right in front of me that he could put his head up in and shoot the sun, you know. And I think he did that a couple of times. I don't know. In any case, about an hour out of what did I call it? In Africa? Belém to Marrakesh.
Oh, wow.
I think it was Marrakesh. At any rate, we start to pick up a beacon. There was a radio beacon there that we could home on. And Vic was almost dead on. We had to correct the heading about 5 degrees or something. Wow. We zeroed in on it and landed. And we all got down, kiss the ground, of course. You know, it seemed like a good thing to do. We were there a day or two, and then we took off and flew up to Casablanca. And we were there for a day or so. Well, the fighting was still going on, ground forces, in southern Italy. They hadn't gotten to Rome yet. And there were two airports in southern Italy that had been Italian fighter fields. And the crazy engineers, you know, they almost beat the enemy out of a position they've been holding to get their tools, their bulldozers in there and build runways. And, you know, the Germans are right up the street running like hell, you know. Engineers are, what they did during the war was unbelievable. At any rate, there's this dirt strip in the middle of an olive orchard that they've lengthened to something like 5,000 feet or something. I think they finally lengthened it to about 7. But they had to cut trees down to make room for us to park and land. This one landing strip, and it was dirt. And the mats, the steel mats that interlocked that were supposed to go down had been sunk by the Germans in the seaport. I think it was in Bari on the east coast of southern Italy. So when we were clear, we flew from Casablanca over to Tunis, which was the closest thing to Sicily and in Italy. And we got there, and most of us collected. I think we lost one airplane on the way. It ran into something. I forgot what it was. There's a mountain range in North Africa there. And there was a lot of weather, and it seems to me he got lost and hit him and descended trying to find the ground and ran into a mountain, as I recall. It's a long time ago. And but that's the only crash, that's the only accident we had on the way over. I lost an engine. Matter of fact, it was number two engine beside me when I landed in Puerto Rico and had to wait there for 3 or 4 days for them to bring a new engine down from the States. But it was no big deal. I mean, it didn't, you know, landed the airplane okay and everything, and tested the engine, and it was fine, and we took, you know. So we got over to Tunis in North Africa, and we're out in the desert, and nothing around, and there are hundreds of us airplanes. Well, the fight in North Africa had just, I mean, there were a pile of old airplanes and equipment, bulldozed into a heap, and were on fire. They burned them all up, you know, and the Germans were running towards Egypt, and our guys and the British were chasing them. And I guess it was Patton. And I don't know, was Eisenhower?
Rommel down there still? Rommel?
Yeah, they were chasing Rommel.
Chasing Rommel, yeah.
Wow. And they had beaten Rommel in North Africa. And when we made, when our ground forces made the landings near, I forgot where it was, in Western Africa, why, they took a terrible beating, Kasserine Pass or something. Our ground forces just caught hell, because they're all green kids, you know.
My wife's uncle was killed there.
Is that so?
Kasserine Pass, got overrun by the Germans. He was in the artillery.
Right. It was a terrible fight. But our guys finally, what happened, if I can digress just a moment, I'm reminded that one of the reasons we won the war, we outproduced them. We had more of everything. The Germans had been fighting for years. The Japs were pretty well prepared, but they didn't have that much, you know. They had a dinky little island that had to import everything.
Yeah.
Our submarines got working on their transport and sank almost all their, towards the end of the war, the Japs didn't have a damn thing left. They were, our Navy sank all their ships, our submarines sank all their merchant marine. We had a terrible time in the Atlantic, our guys, our merchant marine, they sunk hundreds, literally, of our transports. And guys, in the North Atlantic, if you got hit with submarine, you know, and you were in that water, 5 minutes,
frozen,
you were dead, And right off our coast, I mean, right off the Atlantic seaboard.
100 miles?
Yeah, 50 miles off our seaboard. At any rate, the war is hell, isn't it?
It is, absolutely.
any rate, we're sitting out in the desert twiddling our thumbs for almost a month. This was the latter part of 43. I think we left the States about November, as I recall. Late, it was the fall. And we wound up in Tunis the beginning of November, I think. And there was no place to go. We just sat there. We went into town, doped around. In fact, this Arabic patch here, we were advised to put them on because it's the only way they had to identify us in town if we got in trouble or something, you know. Yeah. Our name up here, they would be able to read, but this is in Arabic. Yeah. And for some reason, our jackets all got, I don't know who the hell was doing it, but somebody did it. What else have I got for you, Bob? Okay, so we sat there for it was at least the first week in December, 43. We finally got the clearance to take off and fly to southern Italy. So here again, Vic Meeker's up there with his charts and his dead reckoning hat on. And off across the Mediterranean, and he said, "There's Vesuvius over there." We're all looking out, you know. Sure enough, that thing's smoking a little bit. And we went in and landed at this strange little airport with a bunch of tents and one big building, and that was it. And it was a place called Manduria. It was just north of the bay and city of Taranto in southern Italy, right down here.
Yeah.
And we were right here. They couldn't get it. There were airports further north, but they were full of Germans. They were more than a couple of 100 miles away. But they moved us in, and we landed, and we got struck a couple of times by German fighter bombers. We had flak guns around, and they were British, as a matter of fact. Our guys hadn't arrived yet, but the British were there from Africa, I think. Once they chased the Germans out of Egypt into Israel and all along there, you know, they kept moving up through Albania back to Germany. Why, everything, our guys stopped about Egypt, I guess, the Allied forces, and then crossed over to Italy. And then they put the beachheads in at Anzio.
Oh, huge.
Yeah, and they got trapped there. Poor guys were laying out on the beaches, you know. I've forgotten the general's name, but he waited. The landing was successful, but he was afraid to proceed inland up the mountains, and there's a mountain ridge there, and he was afraid to move in because they were having trouble getting equipment and men on the beaches. And he was afraid, and rightfully it turned out he was correct.
Yeah.
If he had proceeded too far, he would have been cut off and
surrounded
and taken prisoner or killed. At any rate, he stopped, and as a consequence, the Germans were able to fortify the hills all around the beachhead, and the guns were zeroed in on the beach, and just pounded the hell out of these guys laying there for a month. As I recall, one of my missions, it was my, I don't know what it was, 8th or 10th mission, I don't know, I led about 2 dozen B-24s off, and we flew west, out over the Aegean, I guess, and up towards Sicily, and then turned in towards the beachhead at, I think, 4,000 feet. Wow. We wanted to bomb the ridge with 500-pounders because they'd been in there with lighter. And the battleships couldn't even dislodge. I mean, they were offshore, pounding these ridges, and the Germans had the monastery, and they were looking right down at all these guys, and the fatalities and so forth. This was my first mission out of Manduria was Christmas Eve. We were loading 500-pound bombs on the airplane.
Wow.
So Christmas Day was our first mission, and I think it was in northern Italy someplace, because the Germans are still running like hell. Any case, I led this crowd across. The reason to approach from the beachhead was if we came the other way, we might have had bombs that overshot the target and hit our own people. So we knew if we went this way over our own people, we wouldn't release.
Yeah.
We could see them. Yeah. We were low. I mean, we didn't bomb at 5,000 feet. We bombed, at 20, 25,000 feet all the time. Oh, cup of coffee, huh?
Thank you. So you're a captain now. You're still first lieutenant?
First lieutenant.
Wow.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I guess I was first lieutenant. Okay. Yeah, well, I don't know. I've forgotten about it. It came up. You know, if you stayed alive, you got promoted quickly.
Yeah.
Because we lost so many people. I mean, we had replacement crews coming in singly with new airplanes almost daily. And of my original 10, not my original, but the original 10 crews in the squadron I was in, only two of us came back. There were 8 crews that were shot down. And it started early on, and I don't know what the final count was, but of the original 10 that I was part of, Harvey Helmberger was... AC aircraft commander of, and I've had, you know, my crew. My tail gunner was the only other guy got hurt on my crew. He got a piece of flak through his ankle about 2 weeks after I wound up in a hospital, in a field hospital near the airport in southern Italy. And, but the other 8 guys completed 50 missions and got home successfully. And Harvey's crew, I think he had roughly the same. He had a couple of guys either injured or killed, but he made it back with most of his crew. But out of 10 crews,
that's
like 80%.
Yeah, that's a good ratio.
Yeah.
So it's Christmas Day. That's your first mission?
Christmas Day was our first mission.
So of you had a total of 25 missions.
Yeah.
But your first 24, how did they go?
Well, let me finish the bomb run over the beachhead. They've been trying to dislodge. These guys were really dug in on the high ground, you know. And so we went in there low altitude, and of course the guns were on us. We caught hell. We lost airplanes and everything. But we dropped these 500-pound bombs all over the place. About a week later, they were able to... The ground forces were able to fill in and move out towards Rome.
Wow.
And years later, this is a few years ago, there's a guy whose uncles were in World War II, and I think he's an aspiring pilot. He's an awful nice guy. I can't remember his name. But he has been very active in I'm a member of Veterans of Foreign War.
Sure.
He addressed us one evening at a meeting and said, I run an outfit with a lot of volunteers. We organize trips to Washington because most of you guys have never seen your memorial.
It's nice. Yeah.
And if it hadn't been for Senator, oh man, he got badly wounded in North Africa. He was infantry. He became a senator.
Oh, Bob Dole.
Bob Dole,
yeah.
Yeah. If it hadn't been for Bob Dole, we probably wouldn't have had but it's a beautiful, beautiful. Have you seen it?
I have. It's gorgeous.
Isn't it unbelievable?
Oh,
God.
But you deserve it.
Yeah. Well, it was something. It was a marvelous thing. And we got back in a bus, and they took us to some of the other memorials, including the Air Force Memorial, which was over near Arlington.
Oh.
And it's a wall, but not like the Vietnam Wall. It's a bright, it's not dark, you know, it's a bright marble. And it just has major Air Force engagements on it. And Lynn and I were in a line because I wanted to see What did I want to see? I think I was looking for that, because that was an outstanding mission over the beachhead. The others were high altitude, you couldn't see anything really, you know. Yeah. You just flew the airplane and the bombs went out, yeah, and you tried to get home. Yeah. But this one was low altitude, we saw it all, and I mean, there was all hell going on.
Yeah.
And so we were in line, I'm pretty sure it was for the beachhead. Lynn would remember. At any rate, a guy ahead of me was standing pointing to something on this wall, and somebody was taking a picture of him, you know, his wife or something. Mm-hmm. So when our turn came, I went, and sure enough, it was the beachhead.
Wow.
I said, he was just leaving. I said, were you at the beachhead? He said, yeah, I was on the ground laying in the mud there. I almost lost my feet, frozen feet. I said, I was overhead on March something. And he said, oh, Jesus. He gives me a big hug and a kiss. He said, Christ, you guys saved our ass. I said, well, I said, you guys, I can't believe you survived that goddamn thing. He turned out he was a cop from Milford, Connecticut.
No kidding.
Yeah.
Wow.
Isn't that unbelievable?
It is. It's all over. You know? It's...
Yeah. You run into things like that, oh, Bob. Yeah. I mean, the most unlikely places. Yeah. I'll get talking to somebody and, well, like yourself, yeah, you popped up.
Yeah.
your radar.
In a bar, yeah.
Went,
yeah.
So, the mission started to pile up, you know. We'd get up at dawn and miserable weather, and oh God, the food was terrible, and you know, the living conditions were atrocious, mud and no mats there. The engineers were out every night rebuilding the runway for us, because when the runways were wet, we were heavy.
Boom.
When you start rolling, you know, you leave ruts and tracks, and not everybody got off the ground.
Mm.
You'd accelerate, you'd get to a point where you couldn't stop, you'd run out of runway and hit the trees, and all of a sudden one would, oh, there'd be a terrible bang, and it'd blow up at the end of the runway, full of fuel, you know. The bombs didn't go off because they're not armed yet. But I guess if they got hot enough, they'd explode. I've forgotten.
Yeah.
But the fuel was what happened. But we'd have to wait for takeoff for the smoke to clear.
Oh, boy.
In any case, it was just the living conditions were horrible. What we did was, I mean, it was ridiculous.
Yeah.
You know, what we did. What a lot of guys in the service did. I mean, submariners, can you imagine being 1,000 feet below the surface?
Trapped.
Can't get out. Can you imagine being on a flight deck, working a flight deck, or getting an airplane off and back on again?
Yeah.
And over targets, you know, and so on. It's just staggering. Cats are supposed to have 9 lives.
Yeah.
I can't. I'm a basket full of pussycats. Yeah. I must have run out of my allotment years ago, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
In any case, here I am, still around, shooting my mouth off. But reminiscing is kind of fun. I want to thank you, Bob.
You got to tell me a lot more.
I'm not.
Tell me about your first 24 missions. Anything? I mean, all every, dangerous.
Every one of
all
them.
All flak.
Fighters.
Fighters coming at you. Germans, yeah, are close.
We climb up the Adriatic because it's clear.
Right.
There's no guns around.
Right. Oh, right.
So we climb to our altitude and form up. See, we climb, we take off, we circle the airports a few times until everybody gets
right
in position, each squadron.
Right.
And then you take off. You're out over the Adriatic and you continue your climb, usually 6 airplanes to a formation.
Okay.
The lead and a right wing and a left wing, and then number 4, 5, and 6, sometime on the summer man.
Okay.
And we flew in a javelin like that.
Okay.
So most
of the missions over Germany, or is it still Italy, or
anywhere.
Anywhere.
This is how we operate.
Can be anywhere you go. Wow.
And sometimes we went in trail, but not often. You know, when we went, we stayed in a formation mainly for protection from the fighters, because when you flew in close, you had all these guns. I mean,
50 cals just.
Yeah, when you unloaded, everybody's shooting at these fighters coming in. Of course, we hit our own airplane sometimes, but mainly these fighters, there's a lot of lead headed their way, and we shot a lot of them down. So my guys got, I think, 4 or 5. When I was flying with them, I think we had, I think my gunners had knocked down 2, maybe 3, I've forgotten. And we put, right under my window, we put the fighters that we had shot down. Oh, and nice. On the other side, we put the bombs of the missions we had flown.
Wow.
Any case. Oh, and we had a picture. The name of my airplane was Tough Ship, with a P. I had had engine trouble, okay, and got the in the oak of over drinks. Wolcott, you're never going to make it. That airplane you picked, that you were given, just isn't going to get where we're going. So the crew, Tough Ship, was, okay. Yeah. And so some member of the crew got somebody someplace and painted some broad leaning like this on the side of the airplane with Tough Ship written through it.
Nice. You ever have any pictures of that?
Yeah.
Oh, dude, good. So.
But Tough Ship flew, when I left it, I flew 25 in it, and it went to something like 80 or something.
Did it?
Yeah. And then somebody ran into it on the ground, into the tail, and wrecked it. But it was one of the few original airplanes. All the airplanes kept coming, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
Almost daily we'd get another airplane or two coming in from the States. Okay, so I've forgotten the sequence, but I remember we bombed Pisa. We were cautioned to stay away from that leaning tower, you know, but the harbor was what we were after, because the Germans were being evacuated and all that kind of equipment was coming in and so on. But the Germans were headed for the Alps, northern Italy. And we bombed some of them, we bombed some bridges, and we had alternate targets all the time because the weather was so bad. We'd take off, we'd start off in formation, if we were lucky, in the late winter, why we sat a lot on the ground. We were on the ground a lot.
Yeah.
We just couldn't fly.
Right.
With days on end because of the weather.
Right.
And the cold was terrible. It was like living in a house at 40 degrees, you know. Mm-hmm. Oh, God, it was cold.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there's nothing to shower. You couldn't clean yourself. Oh, yeah. God. Yeah. In any case, war is hell.
Yeah. Yeah.
So you learn to live with that junk. And you can't help but think of the troops out laying in the mud all night, week on end.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
Okay, so our targets were basically, in Italy, was transportation and bridges and railroads that we were after, you know. And we did a little of that, but not much. But as the bomb line moved further north, past Rome and on up into Italy, more airports opened up and more guys came in and filled them up. So we were putting 1,000 airplanes. When I got hit on my 25th, which was on April 3rd of 44, by that time we had P-51s and P-49s, and the Messerschmitts were no match for them.
So they were protecting you?
They flew us all. They had fuel. Wing tanks, they could take us all the way to the target and back.
Wow. How far could you go in a B-24 from range?
Well, if you had to go, I've kind of forgotten the numbers, but we had roughly 10, 12 hours of flying time.
Okay.
But missions were usually 5 to 6 hours round trip.
Okay.
7 hours maybe to the oil fields, some of the further oil fields. And we bombed Munich and Regensburg and not the cities, but the factories.
Yeah.
We weren't after cities. We didn't care about that. But the factories where they built things.
Yeah, yeah.
And railroads. Not railroads per se. Marshalling, big railroad yards, you know, that we were after.
Wow.
And, of course, the oil fields were the main thing. And so the missions kept heading on, you know, and all of a sudden you're up in your 20s and you're still alive, but an awful lot of the people that you went over there with are gone. And there wasn't a hell of a lot of humor left in it, you know. It got to be a real drudge.
Right. So,
a lot of good guys died. Yeah. A miserable death. The airplane's on fire, you know. You can't get out of it. You're burned to death on the way down. But on my 25th, which was just another mission, it was aircraft and marshalling yards just west of Budapest. And we had to fight our way there. We had help with our P-51s and so forth, but there were just hundreds of, because they were concentrating.
Right.
And our guys were new, you know, and so on, and they were up against, well, by that time, by my 25th mission, most of the German aces had been shot down.
Wow.
So things had begun to level out a bit, and our guys, being new, were up against newer German pilots. But they were still aggressive as hell. Yeah. That Messerschmitt and Focke-Wulf were one hell of an airplane.
Protecting the homeland, too.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
You bet.
Yeah.
And what all that entailed, you know. So the mission for the day, get up in the dark, put on whatever you can, go to the John, no shaving, and no hot water. Go to the mess, and I mean a mess, and, you know, frozen eggs and canned milk and all gone. At any rate, you got something into yourself, and then you went to briefing, which was in a big room, a lot of chairs. The end of the room was a stage and a big map of Europe on it. And the string went from southern Italy up the Adriatic to wherever the hell you were going, you know,
yeah.
A red string. And it was laid out by intelligence around known flak places, major cities which were being protected and so on. Waste of time. And well, anyway, one mission I'm thinking of particularly, let me, before I get to my final one. I'm not sure which mission it was, but I was leading, I think, 22 airplanes, something like that, in the right section. The group commander, Mills, was leading around two dozen in the center section. Then there was a left section of another two dozen. And we were headed up someplace in Europe. I've forgotten where the hell it was. And my navigator was, you know, the other people in the formation, their navigator was just doing this, and there wasn't nothing. I mean, they followed me. But they had to pay attention, because if I get shot down, why, they're on their own. So at any rate, we're flying up, and we're well on our way into Germany, and Mills starts a left turn towards the target. And Vic Meeker, my navigator, said, "Where the hell are they going, Ed? We're not to the IP yet." Well, this navigator, I trusted my life. I said, "Are you sure, Mick?" Vic, his name was Vic Meeker, the little guy. I said, "Are you sure, Vic?" He said, "Oh, yeah." He said, "I can almost see the IP up there." the initial point, which is a major thing that we pick out, and then we make a turn one way or the other towards the target, which was about a 5-minute run for bomb release. Okay. So Vic said, "The IP is another 15 miles up the road." I said, "Oh, crap, I'm leading two dozen airplanes. Am I going to follow this guy? I don't know where the hell he's going." Yeah.
Could you radio him? Or you still, you couldn't radio him?
Radio silence.
Radio silence.
So Vic, okay, Vic, I said, I'm going out on a limb, and so are you. He said, I know, Ed. I said, okay. So I take my guys towards the IP. These 40 or 50 airplanes wander off to the west. And I take my guys on up. He said, you're coming up on the IP now. And then when we get to the IP, procedure is I make the turn manually, flying the airplane or with the autopilot. I make the turn. And in heavies, you don't make turns. You don't do evasive action.
Right, right.
You're not flying a fighter.
Right.
You've got airplanes right beside you, so you make 5 degrees,
right,
and they follow you. You know, but it's very gentle. You don't do anything.
Yeah.
And at any rate, I make my shallow turn towards the target. I level out, and then the bombardier is now on his scope. He hits the switch. Now he's flying the airplane through the autopilot system. Okay, so Huff, my co-pilot, myself, is just sitting there watching things, you know. Here comes the flak. The fighters are gone because they don't want to get mixed up in the flak. So we're sitting there, and here comes the flak, and the airplane is doing this and this. I look out. I got a guy here, and I got a guy here. I'm assuming there's a guy here and here and here, and then more behind them because I got, I think I was leading 22 that day. I don't know. And and I don't know, only 22. At any rate, we're making our turn for our bomb run. And Leibody, my bombardier, was really good. And he's making real gradual corrections. You know, he's got crosshairs he's following to get to the target, but it's flying the airplane. And the other guys are flying on me. Okay, so all of a sudden, here comes a flak. I mean heavy. And we had a steel infantry helmet we put on because they hadn't built tin hats for pilots yet, you know. So we put a thing, we did this to it, bugged the sides out to fit over the headset.
Right.
So we put it on. It didn't go on very well. But I put it on because the flak was just going all over the place. And that's 88, you know. Ooh, I mean, that's big bang.
Big,
or 105s maybe.
Yeah.
And it's everywhere, and the airplane is doing this, you know, and you got everything you own crossed.
Yeah.
And just before the bombs were released, there's a terrible bang right beside me. Number two engine is on fire and feathered, and Leibody's still flying the airplane. We haven't released the bombs yet. But I got a fire out there. My flight engineer is trying to isolate the fuel to it. He's screaming in my ear, I'll get the fuel. Yeah. And we hit the fire warning, which did some good, as I recall. But when that bang went off, I did this because I got it through both legs, right below my knees, flak. And I did this, and my helmet disappeared. If I hadn't been hit in the legs, I'd have taken a round right about here, I guess. I don't know. So when I did this, bang goes the hat. The glass all gets shattered beside me. And half the instruments in front of me disappeared.
Wow.
All of a sudden, the airplane goes, and there goes 6,000 pounds of bombs. Well, now I'm on three engines. So I'm leading guys with four engines, if they're still back there. So I got to get out of their way because they're going to run me over. And I got to get rid of the fire. So I'm still conscious. I push the airplane. Don't forget, at 50 below zero, fortunately, no artery was hit and no bone. So I didn't go into shock right away. So the temperature kept me from bleeding to death because, you know, we're 25,000 feet.
Helped coagulate it.
Well, it's frozen.
Frozen,
yeah.
Yeah.
Because they were just flesh wounds right through. I was talking about.
But you had to feel it though.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So, right through everything you're wearing,
right through the airplane.
Wow.
Right through my boat, through this leg, and then through this leg. Two pieces.
And the helmet right off.
And the helmet off.
And no windshield.
Windshield I had, but.
Beside.
Beside me, I didn't have any. It got noisy. And, so as soon as the bomb went out, I took the airplane, hit the switch, knocked the bomb side off, and dove the airplane out of the formation. Number one, to get rid of the fire, hopefully. number two to get out of the way, and number three to get out of the flag.
What? How did you know nobody was below you?
I didn't. But there shouldn't have been anybody there. I mean, I was leading my crowd. This wasn't the mission where, oh, incidentally, we bombed the target, we circled, we saw a bunch of airplanes way over there, and we went on home. Flak, fighters, everything else. But, I mean, I had violated probably, I don't know how many rules doing what I did. But we got the target with our 22 airplanes, I think it was, and whatever. And we go home and landed our thing. And squadron CO I had at the time. When we land, we go in, you know, and have coffee and donuts, whiskey or coffee and donuts, and then a critique for about an hour. And let's see. I'm back now on the one where I went my own way.
Yeah.
And I said, tell it like it is, Vic, and we'll see what happens. So I'm sitting beside Vic. He's telling us that the formation left, and I knew we weren't at the IP. I knew it was another 15 miles down the street, and Ed backed me up, and that's where we went. So they took it all down, you know, and so forth. And later that day, the squadron CO, his name was Davis, he said, what the fuck did you do, Ed? You know, I told him. I said, I'm up there with all these airplanes. I'm supposed to deliver those bombs where they're going to do the most good. I don't know where the fuck Mills went. He said, he circled around and came back and went to the IP and was about a half hour behind you.
Oh.
I said, well, okay. So it ended there. But the next mission I had, I had the executive officer of the group in my right seat instead of my co-pilot.
Really?
He was line checking me.
Wow.
I fucking near told him one of us is going to fly this airplane.
Yeah.
You get the hell off and give me my co-pilot, or I'll get off and you fly the fucking thing if you want to.
Good for you.
No, I didn't. I flew it and I just did my job and let him sit there. And he didn't say much. And I didn't know him. He was I guess he was a light colonel. Yeah, he was a light colonel at the time. And so, you know, we didn't see him at the Oak Club maybe or something, but we didn't mingle. Right. We had our own crowd.
Sure.
But his name was Snaith, I think. He got shot down, I remember reading. Lady survived.
Oh,
he
good.
Was a prisoner and came back. But he was kind of a horse's ass. Anyway, you know, if a guy came in and said something, he told me. He said, I'm sorry to be here, Ed, but he said,
I got to do it.
I got to do it, yeah. Just sat there, not saying anything. Oh, fuck you, Mac.
Yeah, yeah.
But I'm 22 now, I guess, you know. I don't give a shit anymore.
Right.
I got missions to fly and get my ass home if I can.
And my crew to protect.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. And do my job if I can. So that was kind of a highlight, I guess.
Yeah.
Okay, back to the 25th. I'm hurting. And the airplane's in a dive. We're still on oxygen. Flight engineer has got a walk around thing he's trying to stay alive on while he's trying to isolate the fuel to that engine there because we're burning like hell.
Right.
And I'm thinking the wing is going to come off. But I got to get out of the way of these guys and I'm aimed at weather. I figured it's going to be wet in there, that might help, you know. So I just let it go. Herb Huff, my co-pilot, I said, you're flying it, Herb. And I said, level off at 12 or 10 or somewhere so we can get off this fucking oxygen. I think about that time, I was out of it. They got me out of my seat, later I learned, the crew, and got me back on the flight deck underneath the top turret next to the radio operator. And they put a tourniquet on me, I guess, and they stuck me with a morphine or something, you know. I don't remember much. I remember... Huff got the airplane, the co-pilot got it back on three engines and landed.
Wow.
and got a commendation for it. We all got Distinguished Flying Crosses for that trip. And I got the Purple Heart, of course.
Wow.
So during the time, I picked up two Presidential Unit Citations. This is my Eastern Airlines wing and my 31-year pin.
Wow.
So, you know, but if you stayed and stayed alive and continued, why, if you did a credible job, promotions came. We had colonels that were 20, 25, you know, just because they were there to do the job. I mean, the job I was doing called for a white colonel.
Yeah.
But it didn't catch up to me in time.
Right.
Okay, so I remember vaguely them getting me out of the airplane because it was a hell of a job. The bottom of the B-24 is 18 inches, the bottom of the bomb bay. It's a tricycle gear, nose gear, main gear.
Right.
And at the bottom of the airplane is only this far off the ground. You have to lay on the ground to get in the airplane and then get a hold of the bomb racks and pull yourself up in. Awful. And the bomb racks are like this in the middle of the airplane. It's about a foot and maybe 2 foot up here because the bombs are hung here and here, you know. And I can remember being jostled around a little bit, I guess. And then I remember getting dragged across the ramp. And then I do recall somebody putting me in an ambulance. And Ossenkopf, my squadron flight surgeon, was busy as hell with my leg. I don't know what he was doing. And then I don't remember anything. They got me to the hospital. I was pretty dry. I'd lost a lot of blood. There was a chance of gangrene because of the airplane and my clothing and everything going through. What had happened, Bob, was the pieces hadn't hit anything vital except a nerve. Right behind the tibia bone is a nerve this big called the tibia nerve, and it controls everything from there south. Well, it had been blown away. Cut. Not cut, but blown away. Normally, it's an amputation. They take it off right there because nobody knows anything about neurosurgery.
Right.
Number 38 life, I think. You know, 9 lives on the cat. About number 38, it must have been.
Yeah.
I ran under the knife in a pup tent, in a MASH unit. This young kid, right out of medical school, had majored in neurosurgery. He opened up the back of my leg from below my knee, almost halfway down my ankle, and opened me up. He worked half the night sewing that nerve together. Never been done. He had never done it before. Well, maybe in school.
Did you think you were going to have your leg cut off?
I was out of it. I didn't know. I had no clue. I was out of it.
Wow.
So I woke up a day and a half later, it came out of all this stuff, you know, and my leg is up in the air. It's in plaster, mainly to hold the foot up. So, because when they know you're going to be out of commission for a long time, you develop a drop foot.
Oh.
So they have to put your foot at right angles in order to keep the muscles.
Okay.
Anyway, then, and I'm looking, you know, and the surgeon's name was Jack Greenfield. I kept touch with him for years. Young guy, and he came in shortly after I came to, and I didn't know who the hell he was, you know. I said, "How you feeling?" You know, I don't know. And he said, "Well, you were quite a what's the word?
Case. You're quite a case.
Quite a challenge."
Yeah, yeah.
So over a few days, he explained to me what had happened and so forth, and I didn't know, you know. He said, "I pulled it together. Now we left the back of your leg open so we can observe it." He said, "I don't want to close you up because I want to see what's going on." He said, "Don't move much." Not that I was about to.
Yeah.
The pieces that went through here just went through the meat. They didn't do any damage. There's still a piece in here.
Whoa.
About that big.
Whoa.
They missed it. It's still there. It doesn't hurt. But I'll show it to you upstairs if you want.
Yeah.
The piece of flak that he took out of my right leg was about this big. It was in my boot.
Whoa.
And because it had lost its...
Yeah. Umph.
Going through the airplane and two legs. It quit when it got to right about here, I guess. At any rate, I've got it upstairs. You can see the rifling on it and everything.
Oh, man. Jeez.
So Jack explains to me what had happened, and he wants to keep it. He said, now, if this takes, he said, and doesn't pull apart, he said, if it does, we're in trouble. But he said, I'm pretty sure it'll stay there because it's you know, keep our fingers crossed.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so after about, I think it was about 10 days or so forth, he said, I think it's good. I think we can close you up. So we went back in surgery and closed it all up and so on. But if this is successful, the nerve regenerates a centimeter a month. So to get from here all the way to my toes took 3.5 years. So I was in the hospital for 3.5 years. In the hospital system,
right.
I was walking within, I was up on crutches, I don't know, in a month.
Wow.
And then when they took the cast off, that stayed for almost 6 months, I think.
Wow.
Quite a while. Because they didn't want to put any strain on this.
Right.
So that was on there for quite a while, I think. At any rate, Jack got my address, and we exchanged stuff, you know. And then they took me over to Naples and put me on a hospital ship. And I left Naples on a hospital ship June 6th, D-Day. We were passing Gibraltar, and the announcement came over. The invasion's on. Oh, the place went crazy.
Oh, man.
So about a week later, we landed in this hospital, across the South Atlantic, landed in Charleston, South Carolina, and the bands were playing, you know, I'm on a stretcher again, going down the gangplank, and everybody, you know. Really good to be home. Jesus, after all these years, you know, you think you just
never leaves you.
Yeah, you just can't shrug everything off. Particularly when you realize it takes a while, you know, to realize how many guys die. The cost of it in lives, and oh man.
Absolutely. So your parents were happy to have you home?
Yeah. As soon as I got a chance, you know, we were back in the ambulance into the hospital again and getting settled and all the rest, you know. And finally got the phone brought to bedside. And I called home. My folks were up, and they lived in Scarsdale.
Oh, nice.
And, you know, they had gotten word that I'd been hit, but that I was okay. But that's the last they had heard anything. So I thought, no, I'm back in the States, down in Charleston. Now, the hospital system was arranged so that after they had a chance to inspect you, what was wrong with you, what you needed, you were sent to a hospital nearest your home that majored in that kind of work. Yeah. So I wound up in Cushing General in Framingham, Mass.
Oh.
And of course, you couldn't get gas or tires or anything.
Right.
But my folks somehow got a tank of gas and drove up and, you know, and they...
Jeez.
Came in the room where my dad said something like, you crazy son of a bitch. I told you not to do this. And they stayed for a day or so and then had to get back home. My dad he left Wall Street. When he came home from the service, the money was in Wall Street,
yeah.
Not in painting.
Yeah.
It was always his hobby. You know. Oh, he went to Wall Street. when I went into service, he never went back to Wall Street. Oh, he and my mother, stop punching me. What do you think you are, anyway? Huh?
Wow.
So they got in a car and they drove, and they wound up in, I think it was Rockport, Mass. There's a very famous building there called Motif One, I think. It's an old lobster shack right on a point. And my dad had set up his easel, my mother was sitting in the car reading, I guess, and Mo was painting it. And people collected around him, you know, watching what he was doing.
Yeah.
And he was good, but you can see what he does.
The behind you, the photo of you, the painting of you.
Yeah, right.
That's wonderful.
It is, isn't it? Nifty. Oh. At any rate, somebody said, do you teach? But it never occurred to my pop.
Hmm.
But from that point on, he started art classes.
Wow.
And he made a bundle, and he had about 3 or 4 art classes a week.
Really?
He had a barn in Southport, and he turned it into his studio, and he turned it into a school.
Southport, Connecticut?
Yeah.
Wow.
Oh, they moved from Scarsdale to Southport, yeah. And that's where I did a lot of my recovering. Because once I couldn't do anything in the hospital except, once I was able to get up and get around, the therapy started. Not here, but on this one, you know. And just general stuff. Yeah. And the lack of food and everything else. I've got one story I got to tell you, but it can't go on this.
Okay. But the military, you're still in the system. You're still getting paid. You're still getting supported and all that.
Yeah. I'm a captain by that time.
Making rank, yeah.
And halfway through the hospital system, some guy in administration stopped me one day. He said, you're Ed Walker, yeah. He said, you know, I've been going over your 201 file. He said, you've got enough time and grade. You want to be a major? I said, yeah, sure. So I got to be a major.
Nice, nice.
But the only way I can live with it is I was doing the work of a major.
You were doing the work of a lieutenant colonel up there. Yeah.
So I graciously accepted the leaves, you know. And
sure, that's awesome.
So I felt I had earned
it. Yeah, absolutely. More than earned it.
Okay, so the 3.5, I got hit in April 3rd, 44. I finally got out of the service. I think it was September, October, 47.
Wow.
But, I mean, after a year, after they took the plaster off, and the, you know how they check whether the nerve is regenerating? With a needle.
Oh.
It stuck a needle in me.
You could feel it.
It kept going until I got an ouch.
Ow.
Okay? So they, you know, they got up to about here. Ah! Oh, good. You know, it's growing from here to here.
Wow.
So it kept growing, but it took time. And there are a lot of nifty stories that don't dare go on this thing.
Mm-hmm.
I'll have to tell you at the bar.
Sure, but, I like that.
Yeah,
like
you like those.
Wow. So from when you got out of the service, what happened after that?
Okay, so when my last hospital stop was Walter Reed in Washington.
Nice.
And I got returned to full duty.
Oh, wow.
They did such a good job on me.
Yeah.
Unbelievable.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Jack Greenfield, my surgeon, was chief of surgery in a hospital in Memphis.
Wow.
I had found. I got out in 47. I didn't know what to do. I didn't feel like going back to college. But I had gotten in the... I was almost a year and a half. There's a boys' school in Pawling, New York, and it became an Air Corps or Air Force recuperation center, rehabilitation center. And they had workshops down in what had been classrooms, every tool you can imagine, you know, woodworking, metalworking, plumbing, electrical, whatever you wanted, whatever interested you. You could knit wallets, you know, anything you wanted to do. Well, I had gotten interested in woodworking, and because I'd always liked to make things, you know.
It's beautiful.
And so I got busy when I could get up and get around up at Pawling. I was getting around pretty good then without crutches, I think. I could walk on it. But I had a lot of therapy. This leg was about that big around. It just atrophied right away. You know?
You weren't using it.
No.
Yeah.
And so there was a lot of work, gradually, slowly working on it, you know, until it, and that was painful. But they got it back to where I could do this, you know, and everything. And I still, to this day, a nerve injury is like putting your finger in a 110. Wow, you know?
Yeah.
Well, every once in a while, I get a shot, to this day, down in my toes. It's still regenerating.
Wow.
But I went through that stuff from here all the way down there for, well, still going on. But when it was really growing, it was a real eye-opener.
Yeah, yeah.
At any rate, I got out of the service. I didn't know what to do. I started commercial woodworking. That's right. I set up a little shop in part of my dad. My dad had the second floor of the barn, and I had the first floor, and I got a whole bunch of tools, and I started building. One big job I had, display cases of fishing rods and guns, rifles, for a sporting goods shop that was opening. That was a big deal.
Yeah.
Then I did all the make yourself comfortable. That's a good boy. So I made all the counters and shelving for small 5 and 10 cent store in Scarsdale. Stuff like that. But I got more interested in the 18th century, for some reason, caught my attention.
Yeah,
and I got more interested in 18th century furniture.
Yeah.
And then I got into houses. My folks got a house with a barn in Southport, and a house never had the utilities. There was a privy outside and a pump in the kitchen.
Wow.
So before they moved in, I had never done a house, but I called in subcontractors and said, we need plumbing, we need heating, we need... I supervised, sort of, and followed these guys around and got the job done. And I was living at home at the time. And the barn was a perfect shop. And I continued making furniture and started doing houses. A piece of property came on the market across the street from in Southport. It was quite a historic 3 or 4 houses in Southport. And I was afraid somebody would come in and put up a split level or something and wreck the atmosphere of this farmhouse and barn. And across the street with a maple tree this big in the front yard was a 17th century house, a little salt box. It was a gem. Somebody restored it.
Yeah.
Matter of fact, a friend of my dad's had gotten, when he came back, he got into the automobile business and he wound up having a dealership of Cadillac Oldsmobile in Bridgeport and Danbury.
Wow.
And during the war, he no automobile, so he got all these government contracts. He was making everything, and, you know. He made a bundle. So he and my dad, mother and the wives was very friendly over the years. And he bought all this property there at an auction or something and did over this early house properly. And he built a beautiful salt box down on the harbor in Southport for his own, and he made a deal my dad couldn't say no to for the farmhouse and barn. So they moved up there, and it was a great setup. And I got into building houses. I bought that property on my own and designed. I was always handy with a pencil, mechanical drawing in school, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I was finished the syllabus, the required stuff, in a week or two.
Yeah.
And the teacher had me doing stuff for him. You know, I was handy with a pencil. I didn't know the code, so I got a code, found out how big a 2x4 or 2x8 or 10x12 had to be, you know, to span the joint. And I depended on sub for the utilities. And I put a little house together and sold right away. Made a few bucks, and hey, what's wrong with this?
Yeah.
So I did, I think, 8 or 9 houses. down in Fairfield. Most of them 18th century. I didn't want to mess with new stuff. And I didn't want to build on contract for people. I built what I wanted to build like this and then put it on the market. Right. It sold right away, you know. Oh, so now we're up to about 1950, 51, I think. 1950. At a cocktail party, a neighbor somewhere around was an airline captain, TWA or something, and we were telling war stories. He said, geez, you must have a bunch of heavy time, heavy meaning four engine time, which is at a premium, you know. I said, well, I said, I think I got almost 1,000 B-17 hours and probably a little more than that in B-24, plus another few hundred in training. I said, a couple of thousand hours, I guess. He said, right after the war, there were pilots galore, and the airlines weren't doing much yet, so they all scattered. You know, they all got something else to do, most of them. Right. Some got an airline job, but not many. But by 50, the airlines were exploding, and there were no pilots. They were taking guys with sandlot time, just pencil time. I mean, a couple of hundred hours, maybe, you know, of cub time. Mm-hmm. And training them themselves in their training facilities, and then putting them on a line as co-pilots and learning on the job. Okay, so he said, Christ, he said, you could get a job in here. You come down to TWA, I'm sure they'd hire you. So I said, well, what do I need? He said, well, you have to have a private license, commercial license, an instrument license, and a multi-engine license. I didn't have any of them. There was a time after the war you could convert your military time to civilian tickets. I didn't know. I'd never figure I'd fly again. So, you know, golly. So I went up to Bridgeport Flight Service. Sammy Bracken, a little Italian guy, ran it. I told him my story. He said, you know something? He said, you've got 3 months left of
just more time.
Free education. What they call
it? Oh, yeah, GI Bill?
GI Bill.
Sure.
You got 3 months that the government will pay for you. Wow. So I dug in hard. I got my private, I got my commercial, I got my instrument, and my multi in the 3 months.
Wow.
So I think I went to TWA, and I met some gravel gripper, you know, some office boy, and he gave me a lot of this, you know. God, I think I went to TWA and it was even worse. I think I went to American and it wasn't much good. Sammy Brackett said, call Eastern. It's run by pilots. Eddie Rickenbacker runs it.
Whoa.
He said, give them, because I was kind of discouraged. I didn't want to instruct at Bridgeport Flight Service or, you know.
Right.
He said, you want to fly commercially? Why, just see what happens. So I called Eastern on the phone and they connected me and called me back and I explained the situation. Oh, yeah. We do our hiring in Florida, in Miami. Forget it. He said, no, we'll give you a ticket. Oh, okay. So I went to LaGuardia. There was a ticket waiting for me at the counter. I got on an airplane and wound up down in Miami at midnight. Went to bed for a few hours. Got up in the morning, had some breakfast, went over to Eastern. And there was a secretary there, and I introduced myself and said, I'm applying for... pilot with Eastern. Oh, you want to see Maury Hampson. I remember his name to this day. He was a line captain.
Wow.
Not an office boy.
Right.
And she was pleasant as she could be. Anyway, he's busy. Be with you in a few minutes. Grab a magazine. So I sat down and this big guy came out of a door 15 minutes later, introduced himself. I hopped up and come on in the office. Went in the office, he said, have you had any coffee? I said, yeah, I just had some. Okay, he said, so what's the deal? Well, I said, well, I flew World War II as a pilot with the Army Air Corps. I've got 17 time and 24 time. I said, I had my last trip with the Army Air Corps wasn't too successful. Well, it was successful, actually, because I survived it.
Yeah.
But I said, it was a bad day, and I spent a lot of time getting screwed back together, but before I did anything, I went down and took a class 1 physical. pass it with flying colors.
Good idea.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I said I hold all the licenses. I've got a Class 1 physical and all the other commercial licenses. He said, let me see them. So I handed them to him. You know, and said, he said, it's almost lunchtime. No, what was it? He said, I'm going to go over and have some coffee. Why don't you come with me? I said, yes, sir. So we wandered out of his office over to the Eastern Airlines commissary, whatever the hell it was, you know. And we had coffee and donuts. You want coffee and donuts?
Yeah.
No. Do you?
Yeah, no, I'm good, thank you. I'm good, thank you.
Okay. So we sat and chatted, but he was getting into me, you know.
He was probing.
Yeah. Yeah. But in a nice way. He wouldn't give me any shit or any seniority or anything. I flew with him as co-pilot years later out of Miami. I became a senior co-pilot eventually in New York. I was about to upgrade to captain, but I got down to the bottom of the seniority list again. The lousy trips, the lousy working conditions. You know, it takes 3, 4, 5 years to get any seniority because everything you do is based on seniority. The trip you fly, the equipment you fly, the money you make, everything. So I said, the hell with this, and I transferred to Miami. I was down at Miami base for 2 or 3 years, and I was very senior. So I flew the best trips, and I flew with Maury. Maury had gone back on the line for a while, and he got sick of the office, mm-hmm. and we flew trips together a number of times. And he was nicer in the cockpit than he had been in the office.
Nice.
Oh, and peach of a guy. He had flown to World War I.
What?
Yeah. We had a lot of Eastern guys. Rickenbacker.
That's amazing.
Yeah. Well, this is 1950, see?
Wow.
So they were old.
Yeah.
But there wasn't an age limit then.
Oh, okay.
As long as you could pass your physical.
Yeah, you were good.
You were good.
Yeah, yeah.
Hello there. Are we good to go still?
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
So... I got on with these. So finally in the office, Maury says, he's doing some paper things, and he said, can you come back? He said, we don't have a class going right now, but you have one starting in a week. He said, can you come back down? I said, yes, sir.
Yeah.
He said, good, you're all right. I said, hot damn. So I went back home and went back to Miami a week later and was in a class with a dozen other guys, and we started from scratch one, you know. Because I hadn't been in an airplane for 8 years.
Wow.
And Eastman was still flying DC-3s at the time. I'd never been in one. But it was an airplane.
Yeah.
And you do this and this, like you always did, except a wheel instead of a stick. And I caught on right away and got through the ground school and the flight syllabus I had and so forth. And he said, and after I think it was, I don't know. I don't think I had more than about 7 or 8 hours with training with this year. And they said, you're ready. So they sent me back to New York as a co-pilot.
Wow.
And I flew as co-pilot on most of the airplanes. The DC-3 for, I was, what do you call it? I was on my best behavior for a year.
Yeah. Oh, probation.
Probation.
Yeah, yeah.
For a year with the same captain. And we got along well, fortunately. And after a year, while I was released, I could fly. And I went from a DC-3, I think to a DC-4. Not pressurized, but 4 engines, co-pilot. And after, I don't know, a short time, while I was in a DC-6, which was pressurized, and higher altitude, and a little bit bigger airplane. Then I went to a DC-7, which was even better.
Yeah.
The DC-8 was a first jet. I didn't go there. And about that time, I upgraded to captain with Eastern. I think I flew co-pilot with Eastern for, I don't know, about 5 years, 6 years, something like that. And then I checked out as captain, a little ground school, and of course an instrument check, you know, in the left seat now.
Yeah.
And and in a Martin, twin engine. And a lot of stops like this all over the place, but it was fun.
Yeah.
And then I graduated up through the things that seniority allows you. Why, I checked on the DC-8 finally, four-engine jet, and I finally wound up flying. My last airplane with Eastern was an Airbus,
wow.
an A300. And Lynn went to France with me. They taught over at the factory in southern France. I can't remember. And we did all the ground school and all the simulator work. The simulators by that time had gotten so perfect. When you stepped off the ramp into the airplane and closed the door, you were in the cockpit of an airplane.
Wow.
Okay, the good part of the interesting part of the story, Bob, is that I'd never seen an Airbus. I'd seen pictures of them, and I saw them taxiing around, but I'd never been in one. I finished the ground school and the orals and the written exams. Then I went in the simulator and did all the syllabus in the left seat, you know, with an instructor in the right seat. And behind me, there's a big panel. And, no, I have a co-pilot there who's checking out the airplane also. And the instructor is sitting in a panel right behind me. And he's got all these switches. He can do anything at all. He can simulate an aborted takeoff. He can simulate fire, hydraulic, emergency decompression. He can simulate everything back there.
And throw it at you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's part of the training,
yeah.
Wow. You've got three sections of the manual. Normal operating, abnormal operating, and emergency procedures. And emergency procedures, you've got to have down.
Yeah.
Abnormal, you can do what you think is necessary and then refer to a checklist.
Yeah.
Normal operating, of course, you know, day-to-day stuff. You live with that.
Yeah.
And so I went through all the syllabus and passed all the tests and got my ticket. We came back to New York. I went and, you know, checked in the crew schedule and so on. And I'm home again. Here's my Airbus ticket. Oh, I'm chief pilot's office. And went home. And a couple of days later, I got a call. First trip, Ed. You're going to San Francisco. And, okay. So I check in at the airport and go to crew schedule first, check in with them, then to weather, check the weather, and I've got what we call a Czech airman. He's a guy that's legal in the airplane, but he's scheduled to fly with you for up to 20 hours in the right seat, just to make sure you know what the hell you're up to, and to back you up if you need, you know, whatever. So I knew him from years. He was a senior captain. I knew him well, and we got on well, and we went to weather, and then went downstairs, had coffee or something, went out to the airplane, kicked the tires. I looked around at this fucker. God, this thing, excuse me.
Big. This thing is big, yeah.
Maybe you can scratch some of this.
Don't worry.
So I'm looking at this thing. I said, God, it's awful big, isn't it? And he said, yeah, but you know. So we do the walk around, which is, you know, of course, you got a flight engine. You got a co-pilot who's supposed to do that. No flight engineer, just two pilots. But the senior pilot isn't going to do it, so I'm doing it. And he's checking me, make sure I know where the navigation lights are, where the gear is. And this scissor switch on the gear, what does that do? You know, stuff like that.
Yeah.
And we climb up the jetway, walk in the cockpit, close the door. It's a simulator.
Oh.
I put my bag down the left seat, get in, strap in. And a call for the checklist. I got a co-pilot, right?
Yeah.
He's 12 years my senior, but he's my co-pilot.
Yeah.
I asked for the checklist. We go through the checklist. And we're all set to start engines. They're loading people on and so forth. This is my first trip. I've never been in the airplane. And they're putting 300 people behind me.
Whoa.
I got a crew of 12 girls and a co-pilot. So, just like we always do, we got a clearance to start engines and start them all, just like we did in the simulator. He gets a clearance for taxi. We get a pushback clearance. We taxi out to the active runway. We wait our turn. We switch frequency, the tower frequency, and he clears us into position to hold, which I do. My co-pilot's doing the radio work. And I'm sitting there with this monster, like, trying to forget what hanging on my hand back there. And let's see, the next stop is San Francisco, isn't it? Oh. You're Eastern 123, you're clear for takeoff, roger. And I completed the before takeoff checklist, correct, we've done everything. I say, here we go, push the power forward. And you got a wheel, you know. And there are three speeds, V1, VR, and velocity, V1, VR, V2. V1 is a speed pre-computed based on your gross weight, the temperature, the runway, a whole bunch of factors. But it, you arrive at a speed at which it's computed that you can no longer stop the airplane in the remaining runway.
Wow.
Of course, if you've got a runway 7 miles long, it doesn't mean anything. VR is the next speed, which is about 10, maybe 8 to 10 knots faster. That's when the stick come back and the airplane assumes about 12 degrees of attitude for takeoff. And then V2 is a speed that we call out to each other, at which you can get the gear and the flaps up, you can clean the airplane up, and you can continue accelerating to climb speed, which usually is around 150 knots. The other speeds are 120, 130, something, depending on the weight of the airplane. But climb speed in a control zone was 150 miles an hour because you want to run into little airplanes, you know.
Yeah.
The tower and the departure control now is busy giving you clearances so that you don't run into anybody. And off you go. And then you've got your autopilot, and it's all hooked in with the GPS. And all the waypoints have been put in the computer. And once you're about 2,000 feet, you just flip the autopilot on, and you're climbing at a rate which is, you got a little toggle that you move for any airspeed you want. And the heading is controlled by the autopilot, and you turn a little knob this way or that way to turn the airplane. Of course, you're watching everything else.
Yeah.
And you're looking outside, and you're paying attention to things, of course.
Yeah.
But it's all, it's all mechanical.
Wow.
And then you get out of the control zone, away from the airport, and you're clear to your cruise altitude, and you keep going. Of course, then you start to accelerate to climb speed, which is usually around, I've forgotten, it's usually around 180 miles an hour, 180 knots. And you continue your climb to your cruise altitude. When you approach your climb altitude on the GPS that's already been set on, you never know what you're going to do as you're departing an airport because of traffic and climbing and other airplanes. But once you're cleared en route, you make a turn direct to your next checkpoint. So you just make that turn with the autopilot and hit a button, and the airplane's locked on to that next waypoint, okay? The airplane's continue to climb. It gets to 35,000. Whatever you've set in the little window, the airplane levels off, okay, and away you go.
Wow. Easy.
Easy, So you sit there and you watch everything. You don't do anything. You're ready, though.
If a little coffee.
Yeah. And you call for coffee, of course.
Wow.
But it was quite a, to get paid to do that, it was always kind of a non-starter, you know. You almost felt guilty. Not too much. You trained yourself to overcome gratitude for the paycheck. Because you knew that you had about 95%, maybe 98% of the time, boring. But that other 5% was panic time, you know, when things started to go wrong. If an engine blew, or you had emergency decompression, you had to be ready.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Have you ever had that?
Oh, sure.
Really?
My worst trip with these, my most dangerous, was in a part way through my seniority. I was flying a twin engine jet, a DC-9, and great little airplane, rear drive, that two engines back here.
Great
performer. Out of LaGuardia, middle of the afternoon for Montreal, full of people, heavy as hell and hot as hell. Everything's normal. Taxi into position, clear for takeoff, push the power, start the takeoff roll. Just about V1 is a terrible bang. Number one engine blows up on me.
Whoa.
Fortunately, there are two sections to the jet engine. There's an intake section with a whole bunch of fans. I think there are about 8 fan sections. Then there's a combustion section. Then there's the rear turbine. I think there are 4 or 5 blades on that. That's hooked to most of the hydraulic system and other stuff. The front end is for power. Okay? That's for airspeed. And then the exhaust section. In the vernacular, I'll have to tell you when this is on.
Yeah.
But we have our own terms for certain things.
Yes.
At any rate, the engines are... Jet engines are so much better than the old internal combustion engines. You had a million parts doing this, you know?
Yeah.
Anything could go wrong. Yeah. With a jet engine, unless they blow up like this one did, why, they seldom give you any trouble. But bang, right at V1, well, I can't stop the airplane anymore. I'll go in the water. My God, you got short runways.
Yeah.
So I got to continue the takeoff on one engine. Well, I had built up enough speed so I was able to accelerate to just about V2, which is only something like 5 knots above stall. So I think I had 60 people behind me, and I got a crew of 4, myself, my co-pilot, and 2 flight attendants back there. And here come the bridges. I'm taking off on runway 4, right at the Whitestone, right at Throg's Neck, Whitestone, and then Throg's Neck. I'm aimed right at them. They're 480 feet high. Well, not this, but this is.
Top, yeah.
And I'm aimed right at it. Well, I have to level the airplane off for stall. But I don't have any power. I've got this one engine, you know. And I looked at the meter on it, and it's almost at the red line for power. I push it up a little bit more for power. Just a skosh past the red line, but not much. That may have saved my ass.
Wow.
Just that little bit. I leveled off at something like 400 feet, doing V2 on the one engine. I had the gear up. I didn't pull the flaps up because I didn't know what would happen. We never trained for a V1 failure.
Wow.
You're trained for a failure on takeoff, but they usually do it after you're off the ground. But in the syllabus, there's no V1 failure. I got on Eastern's ass through the training command. I made him put me in a simulator and simulate it. A couple of months later, when I was down there for required semi-annual training, and you get almost a week of twice a year of ground school and flight training, bringing you up to date what's happened lately. So I said, I was sitting in the ground school, and the instructor is saying, we had an incident at LaGuardia recently where the captain lost power at V1. He got the airplane around. Some guy in the class said, he's sitting right there. He said, is that you, man? I said, yeah. He said, what happened? So I told him. I said, because I wrote it up.
Yeah.
If I had written it up the way it happened, I'd have wound up to here in lawyers and the FAA. Okay? I'll finish the story on that part.
Yeah.
So I'm aimed at the thing at 400 feet, 300 or 400 feet. I can't accelerate anymore. I've got takeoff flaps on. It's some drag, but it's also some lift. I'm afraid if I retract them at the airspeed I'm at, I'm going to do this.
Yeah.
I'm flying. I got a stable airplane. I'm only 400 feet, but... And here comes Throg's Neck. Well, I can't turn there. Where am I going to go with this goddamn thing? Okay, the other guy took it into the Hudson River.
Sullenberger.
But I got an airplane that's flying. But every everything around is houses and, you know. Right. The only thing I got is East River and Long Island Sound. I came this far from putting it in the water around New Rochelle, so I'm marrying it, you know.
Wow.
Well, if I commit myself to a turn and this one barks, I'm done.
Right.
I'm cooked and all everybody behind me. And as they love to say, the cockpit crew are the first ones to arrive at the scene of an accident.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay, so I figure I can't put it in the water. So, of course, my co-pilot said, declare an emergency. Once you do that, he calls the tower. The tower said, you got a problem, Eastern? I said, tell him. And he said, oh, yeah, we got a problem. We just blew number one. We're declaring an emergency. That gives you, you own the airspace. So I can do anything I want. Okay, what do I want to do? Oh, I tell you, Bob, I earned about 5 years flight pay. Finally, I said, I got to go back to Asgard. Tell him I'm going to take a right turn and land on 31. That's a cross runway.
Okay.
It comes right across the old fairgrounds and tennis place.
Sure.
Now.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
I took off on this one, but it's shorter to go all the way around to this one. But fortunately, the weather was good and the wind was fairly calm. I didn't have to worry about crosswinds and everything.
Yeah.
I got a single engine approach and landing, which was no big deal. I don't have any altitude. So I continue around Throg's Neck. I make a very gradual right turn around. Now I'm going through downtown Bayside or whatever the hell it is. There are buildings that are almost 400 feet high. Lynn was in the apartment. She had an apartment on an inlet around Bayside or somewhere. I don't know. Lynn? Were you home the day I blew that engine?
Yes.
Yes. Were you out on the deck?
No.
Oh, okay.
I didn't see you go by it. That level.
I couldn't remember whether you watched this crazy Eastern airplane flying 400 feet.
No, but the toll booth operator did at the Throg's Neck Bridge.
Oh, I looked down, you know. No, this way, and because the bridge went this way, you know.
Yeah.
I avoided this. I took a little bit, and I looked down. A toll booth guy was outside.
Oh my gosh!
Not funny.
No.
So, any rate, I made it all the way around. I avoided the building.
Yeah.
And came in across the thing. I still had takeoff flaps, and when I was sure of the runway, I got gear down. Continued the flaps, crossed the runway, put it on the ground, and taxied off the runway, so I didn't block the airport, even though they weren't using it.
Yeah.
Some other guy might need it.
Sure.
Shut the engine down. Picked up the PA. No, let's see. I told my co-pilot to secure the airplane, because wow, 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 wow is all around me, you know.
Yeah.
And the engine's fine. It's dead. Fortunately, no fire. If it had been the forward compressor, I'd have had a terrible time. I'd have had a real fire roaring back there. But it was a rear turbine and exploded. I've got one. Lynn and I went over to the airport when I got back to the apartment. I went on with the trip. At any rate, we went back over to the airport that night. And there was a basket underneath the airplane full of the blades from the engine. They took the engine out and put a new engine in it, you know. And I picked up one of the blades, and I've got it upstairs.
Son of a gun.
Any rate, I got out of the seat, and all these people are sitting back there, and, you know, but everybody had behaved themselves. The girls were great. Mm-hmm. They had made people certain everybody was stay calm. Mm-hmm. We got a good crew. Everything's going to be all right or something. I don't know. Mm-hmm. So I got up and faced them with the PA system. I said, well, here we are, folks, or something to the effect. We're back on the ground. We're safe. And you can all relax. Big, yeah. I said, we're going to get off this airplane just because it's the proper thing to do.
Oh.
Leave everything here. We'll get it later. Just come forward and go down the stairs, and somebody down there will take you, you know, away from the airplane a ways, and we'll deal with you there. So they all came off, and And I think I got one letter from some guy in Montreal, didn't I?
Well, you got several letters.
Yeah. At any rate.
And Frank Borman, to thank him for doing such a wonderful job of saving the airplane, gave him a free ticket to San Juan.
I can go there any time I want.
You had been there before. Yeah, you had been there before.
Anyway.
Anyway.
Borman, a big spender. But he didn't know the full deal. Yeah. Okay, when I got off the airplane after people were on, I think I joined them as they were leaving because there was a lot going on I wanted to see back there. And they still had the co-pilot. You know, he shut the airplane down and did the checklist. I don't know when I went over to the people or not. No, the FAA showed up. Here comes a car with a federal thing on it. You know, and two guys came out, give me this stuff. And of course, I got my jacket on. What happened, Captain? Well, if I tell them anything, it's going to bite me in the ass. So I said, nothing. I said, I lost an engine on takeoff, circle and landed. And they look at each other, you know. And, well, I said, that's all it was. So they said, okay, we'll call it an incident then. I said, yeah, that'd be okay. So I said, I'll see ya. And I left them and walked behind the airplane where they were, all these guys were beating on the engine. You know? They were trying to open it up. And I guess the nacelle was all messed up. And some of the blades just missed the rear flight attendant seat. Came right through the airplane.
The rear flight attendant seat was right between the engines back there on DC-9.
She was lucky she didn't get killed. Mm. At any rate, the flight crew was exemplary. The girls were great. Okay, so we get back inside, everything calms down. I call a crew schedule and tell them, you know, we had an incident. And what are you going to do, Ed? So I said, I don't know. So I turned to my co-pilot and I said, we're all dressed up. You feel like going home? He said, I'll do whatever you do. I said, okay. The girls are from Atlanta or someplace. I said, you want to ride to Atlanta? You want to work to Atlanta? I said, yeah, okay. So I said, crew schedule, give me an airplane. We'll continue the sequence. We were to go to Montreal and back to Newark, I think, and then continue a couple of stops somewhere. And so we took a cab over to Newark with our flight bags and stuff, and the four of us, and we're joking and kidding around, you know. And we go out and kick the tires and say, well, you think this one will work? But in all those years, 31 years, thousands of takeoffs and landings.
That was it.
That was it.
That could have been it, though. That could have been...
Oh.
What year was this?
It was probably around 76.
Oh, yeah. I retired 82, didn't I?
Right.
You had to retire at age 60, so I was 60 at 82. Mm-hmm. So that was the end of my 40-year aviation career.
Wow. Ed, this was amazing. This really was.
Well, I got some others that you might enjoy, but
we'll do that at the club.
We'll do those on our own time. Bob.
Yeah, yeah. Wow. Well, thank you so much for your time, and Lynn, thank you too. Well, I mean, it was really amazing. I'll get you a copy.
This one, you know, my dear wife had 15 years in the cabin. She was a flight attendant with the Eastern for 15 years. We met on her second trip or something.
That's it.
No, about 4 months into flying.
Wow.
And,
okay.
We met on a Constellation trip.
Wow. Neat.
Yeah.
That is neat stuff.
But you're very kind to do this.
Oh, no.
It's really...
My pleasure. Great. My pleasure.
Well, it's fun to reminisce. It's a little tough sometimes. Yeah. But, you know, it was a really great career. It was certainly better than working for a living. In fact, I had to work when I went home building out. I built houses, you know.
Yeah, but that's fun.
Yeah,
yeah. And so you the Eastern Airlines paid the rent.
Yeah,
more than that. But you know, you had fun building houses because that's a passion.
A lot of fun, and we've had a lot of fun doing it together.
Yeah.
Over the years. How many have we done together? Seven or eight?
Wow.
About a dozen.
Yeah.
I heard about Smith Neck. Telling me about Smith Neck Road.
That's
you know?
Right. Yeah. That's one of the few we did from scratch. Usually we renovate.
Yeah, yeah, I remember saying that.
But we bought the property. It had three building lots. And, oh, great, on Smith Neck, we can build three houses. Wow. Yeah. Well, we got studying the property and getting up on the ridge there and looking at the marsh and the river, and we said, this property doesn't deserve, it doesn't want three houses. It wants one big one.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So that's what we did. And we spent 2 years working on it.
Wow.
We were there 6 years.
Yeah, planning and execution, and we moved three times, didn't we?
Yeah, we were in rentals, and they kept selling.
Oh,
I don't ever want to do that.
I know.
It was a nightmare, but
it was kind of a nightmare, but...
But we got it done, you know?
Yeah.
We ran into trouble with the town a little. Lynn has got the patience of...
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I don't. Mm-hmm. All my life I've been saying this.
Yep.
Or pointing at him. Right. You do it.
You do it.
So when I run into somebody that you know, is exerting power, I get, oh, man. Yeah. Anyway, they had a woman in town hall in the town at the time who was the, what was she, the enforcement officer.
Yeah.
Zoning or something. Yeah.
Yeah. And I wanted to build a barn. And move everything that we had scattered all over the place in the barn, furnishings, you know, everything.
Before building the house.
Before
okay.
building the house. Okay. We had the house planned, but it was still out there. We were getting prices and so on, you know. And we weren't quite ready for construction there. Well, she said, well, you can't have a permit until I see the plans for the house, too. I said, I'm going to put a barn up. I said... You know, the house will come.
Yeah.
Oh, no, no. I think I stormed out of there. You had to go back over and smooth it out, I think. Lynn went back over and said, don't pay attention to him. He doesn't. He was an army guy.
Yeah, used to getting his way.
Yeah, yeah.
That's
right. And I think you probably said, you got off lucky, young lady.
Yeah.
He could very well have punched you out.
I don't think so. No.
Any rate, Lynn has since taken care of all the work that entailed permits and so on.
It goes better.
It goes a lot better, yeah.
Oh, that's great.
Talk about XOs.
Yeah, it's a good XO, huh?
Oh, the best.
Wow.
We've managed to put up, I don't know how she's managed to put up with me. I found it very easy putting up with her for 44.
Oh my gosh. Congratulations. That's fantastic.
Isn't that neat?
That is neat.
Yeah.
That's neat.
Yeah.
Any rate, Robert.
Well, thank you, sir.
Are we done?
We're done.
Oh, okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bob.